link that you sent out yesterday, Lisa, it was just a case of clicking on it and going straight in.
Yeah, that's what I thought too, that the Sim link should Okay. I like you said, Martin, maybe we can record also so we can share it
Yeah,
if there was some problems with the link.
I think Frederick can push the record button because I don't have the administration rights. Ah, you're recording. Perfect. Thank you. Lisa, it's
Great.
up to you.
Yes. Hi and welcome everyone to this webinar on how portability of reputation data can contribute to better position of platform workers. It's great to see you all here. My name is Lisa Hanf and I'm representing JobTech Development, which is part of the Swedish Public Employment Service. I'm really happy to be able to welcome Martin, Tim, and Jeroen today to share their research on this topic. I'm also happy for the possibility to use the Zoom account that belongs to Companion. It's sometimes challenging being an authority and using all these different digital tools. So for that, we're grateful. And Martin will be our moderator for today. I will give you an introduction to JobTech Development and the work we are doing, and then I will hand over to you, Martin. And feel free to use the chat for any questions or comments, and we will make sure to address them. So going through the agenda, as I said, I will start with an introduction, and then I will hand over to you, Martin, to get us into more of the context. And then just before 10, Tim will tell us more about his research. He has written several research papers on the impact of reputation data portability on e-commerce and sharing platforms. And after that, Jeroen will present his results of research on how platforms consider portability of reputation data and what conditions apply. Around 10:50, we will have a 10-minute break, and then Martin will share his research results. 11:20, we will divide you up into smaller groups for a discussion. I think that Martin has prepared some questions for us to discuss. And then we will gather back here just before lunch and get some feedback from the different groups and talk about the next step. But I will start by giving a short introduction to JobTech Development. As I said, JobTech Development is part of the Swedish Public Employment Service, and we're building a digital infrastructure with the mission of a sustainable and more effective matching, digital matching on the Swedish labor market. We have three different focus areas. The first one is what we call labor market data, where we create, collect, and quality assure data. This could be, for example, data related to job advertisement to give people and companies better conditions to be able to develop in the labor market. And then we have our second focus area, which is language data. So we create a common language for the Swedish labor market for a better digital matching. And then we have the third focus area, which is also in focus here today. So we create opportunities for individuals in the labor market to own, use, and move their own data in a simple way. So one example of this is that we have created a tool for the job seeker to be able to bring with them their CV data to other job sites. Another example is how we work with the unemployment status. So that data could be of value for the job seeker, for example, if they would like to get unemployment insurance. So we made a a digital infrastructure that makes it easy to move that data to the relevant actor that the job seeker wants to move it to. And this is also where we focus on the value for individuals to bring their own ratings, to bring the ratings and reviews from one platform to another platform. And we're also looking into the possibility to bring gig data from one platform to the more traditional CV. And we're exploring this through what we call open platforms. So we're really looking into the way we could build a digital infrastructure that makes it possible to export data that is from if someone has been active on a gig platform and bring it into another platform. So we have quite a few discussions with different, mostly Swedish platforms regarding this. We also talk to a lot of people that are engaged on platforms. And when we talked about also bringing their gig data into more of the traditional CV, they said that the CV does not, it's not a structure that's possible for us to use. So we talked about a digital backpack instead. So this is more like a proof of concept or an example service that the gig worker can use like a CV. So they can export their data from a platform and present it in this digital backpack way. And why we're here today is that, of course, the research, and we've been in contact with Martin since a few years back, and the research he's really doing now with the focus on how online reputation scores within the gig economy may contribute to a more inclusive labor market and increasingly empowered workers. It's, of course, very relevant for us as a public employment service and how we can work on that and create a sustainable digital infrastructure. And we would like, with this event that we're now arranging, to explore and continue the dialogue with stakeholders that has the same mission to create a sustainable and digital infrastructure for data portability in the gig economy. And Martin will of course talk more about this. I also want to mention GigLab Sverige or GigLab Sweden. You see the logo on my slides. And this, we have invited to this event also from GigLab Sweden. And it's a national policy lab and collaboration between Job Tech Development and the Swedish tax authorities. We have Companion, who's also with us today, who focus on cooperative platforms. And Stockholm School of Economics are also involved, and SWID, which is the Swedish Industrial Design Foundation. So our ambition with this GigLab Sweden is to work together for a sustainable growth of the gig economy in Sweden. And we've conducted two workshops so far, one with gig workers and one with platforms. And tomorrow we're bringing authorities together to have the discussion. And then 1st of December, we're bringing all the perspectives together for a last and fourth workshop. And of course, you're all very welcome to that workshop. And I will, at the end, share the link with you to that invitation. And with that said, I think I'm going to hand over to you, Martin.
Yeah, thank you very much for this introduction. let's see if you maybe can stop sharing the screen, Lisa. Yes, very good. And Fredrik, maybe if you can pin my video. Let's wait for that. Fredrik, okay, maybe pin my video. Okay, I will just start. You can, because my video will be like this. Ah, thank you very much. Perfect. So good morning. So Lisa, also thank you for your kind introduction. I'm I'm here calling from Utrecht, the Netherlands. The workshop supposed to be offline in Stockholm, but yeah, due to some COVID stuff, it was a better option to do it online. Maybe it's nice because there are now quite some people over here in the meeting. I see 21. Maybe if you just put in the chat, there's a chat below, just where you're based, so we know where on earth you are, but also your role and also maybe your main question and the reason why you're joining, because I think it's nice to just meet each other in the chats. It's not so good as meeting each other with some coffee or beer, but yeah, it's a start, but also to have some more insightful information on what your background is and what your expectations are, so why you're here in this digital space. I will start with my workshop. Let's see over here. First, thank you for joining us today. I always forget it, so I always put a slide at first, because I think it's really nice just to be here together in this digital environment to share knowledge and also insights in the topic of the portability of reputation data for gig workers. I'm Martijn. So as I already mentioned, I'm based in Utrecht. I'm living in Houten. It's kind of a suburb of Utrecht. I'm an independent professional outsider. So the term professional outsider means that I'm not linked to any institution, which makes me independent. And I'm really good to look from the outside in perspective to what happens at different stakeholders. And I'm really also driven by curiosity. So I have my own company, and I'm exploring the platform economy now since 2012. So I did about 500 interviews in 16 countries and counting. And I'm also working together with all the stakeholders in debates. Now mainly focused on Netherlands, because it's really hard to have contact with all the stakeholders in one country. And the same thing in Europe is quite a challenge. And I've also wrote some books. And my last book is called Platform Revolutie, The Revolution of the Platform Economy, where I describe the whole upcoming of the platform industry in Europe. I hope there will also be one day a English or maybe Swedish translation for that. So I'm also quite active in the Dutch media to try to get the right message out, because the debate in the Netherlands really outstands in a lack of knowledge on the subject. So I try to bring the knowledge also in the public debates, and I also work together with a team of others to do this. My interest in the portability question came because I'm doing quite some research already now for 8 years on the platform or gig economy. I organized a workshop last summer. Lisa and Niels also attended, because what I saw was that most questions on platforms are around gig economy, because it really links to many different other existing discussions. And I also saw that more and more people are working via platforms. What I also saw was that platforms, they are really inclusive, because they don't exclude people for working or start working for them. So also many people with a background, with no labor market backgrounds, they had the opportunity to start working via platforms. Then I also thought, okay, but at what way, because if more and more people are starting to work via platforms, how then can we capture this experience on platforms so they can also use this in the next phase in labor markets? And then this paper appeared a year ago. The question, does education still matter in labor markets? And that really proved, and of course there's quite some discussion on this paper, but in basic it proved that's okay, and it's also really logical at the moment that you have no diploma and you're doing more practical work where a diploma isn't required, your reputation data is more important than your diploma to get new work. So I thought, okay, but when people are going to work more and more via platforms, how can I make sure that the data is also secured and isn't a lock-in for platforms to keep people on the platform? So how can you unleash this data for the benefits, I think, for the benefit of all? So that is also why I started this research on the portability of reputation data for gig workers. So really focusing on the gig economy. So really labor via platforms. So no Airbnb and no car sharing, only labor. And now the focus is mostly on offline labor. Because if you want to work together with platforms, it's nice when they're also in the same country. that is the case of the offline labor platforms, but not for the online labor platforms. I'm also doing this research together with some other partners. They're also financing the research, and I really try to make a mix of different kind of stakeholders, because I really believe that these issues only can be solved from a multi-stakeholder perspective. So they're mostly of them are Dutch. So the Dutch Employment Service is joining. Young Ones is a platform. Sietsemiet is a platform. The Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate. JobTech is also one of the partners. The A3, the European Trade Union Institute. Freshheads, that's a tech agency. And FNV, that's the biggest labor union in the Netherlands. So I really try to have all the voices in the debate, because I believe that's the only way to move these kind of things forward. The timeline, I started in April last year, this year. It seems like time flies, but sometimes it doesn't. The main questions are about online reputation, about portability, how can you also scale it? And in the end, how can you also secure this continuity of this data? I'm going to talk to about this later after the keynotes of Tim and Jeroen. And I think it's also important to make today's goal clear. I think that the goal is really to explore also together under which conditions the portability of reputation data adds value for the worker, because it's nice to export data and everybody's saying, okay, give the worker his data and he or she is free, but then they will get a Excel sheet with 20,000 different data points and they can do anything with that. So it's also a question, okay, but how can you also make it work for them? And then in order then to address the most important questions and obstacles in the workshop, which will be in the final part of this workshop. Maybe also nice to share some results of CBS, that's the Central Bureau of Statistics in Netherlands. They did a research also under platforms, but not only gig, but also platform broad. And there they saw, okay, that 55% of all platforms do not have a rating system. So I think it's also really important to understand that also many platforms, also in gig economy, don't use ratings. some of them are now looking for it, but there are also quite some platforms that don't use a reputation system. And of course, the question is also in the to-business market, how scalable is reputation scores? Because when platforms, gig platforms, are going to behave more like temp agencies, so when at a company 20 people are working each day via a platform, then the HR manager that doesn't have any idea what they are doing will never fill in every day 20 different ratings. So there's also a question about this scalability. Another result of the research was that they also asked questions, okay, because I asked them to put this in the questionnaire. They also asked the question, should providers of online platforms be able to transfer their reputation to other platforms? And there you see it's in Dutch, but it's from the left, agree, to the right, disagree. And you see the middle, neutral. So the biggest part of the platform, they are neutral in these discussions. But the nice thing is only a smart part, a small part, 20.1% disagrees. So also the sentiment for the platforms is positive. Although, of course, in the end, we also always need to see, okay, do they also put their money where their mouth is? So are they also really going to join? Because it's, of course, social nice answer to say yes, but then the question is, of course, okay, and then. But I think it's a nice basis. So I also invited two speakers, two of my colleagues. They're also a member of the Scientific Research Council of the Research. Tim Teubner, he's based in Berlin. And Tim has done quite some amazing research on the portability of reputation data, mostly focusing on e-commerce platforms, because e-commerce is, of course, much more mature than gig platforms. And of course, it's easier also to do more cross-sector comparison with e-commerce than with gig. And after Tim, Jeroen Meijering will also do a presentation where he shares some results, because he and some of his students, they did the research at interviewing different stakeholders on what questions they have around this portability question. So that's a much more practical approach. And after that, I will share some of my results and thoughts, and also some results, because we're already now working together with 6 platforms in the Netherlands to make this happen. So I will also share some insights for that. So that's now for me. So I would like to give the floor to Tim. And Tim will share his insight from his research he did the past years.
Right. Thank you, Martijn. And thanks, everyone. Hello, everyone. And thanks for having me here today. As Martijn mentioned, I'm a researcher here in Berlin, Technical University of Berlin, and the Einstein Center. And I'm in the area of information systems. And most of my research groups work and my own work is in the area of online platforms and mainly e-commerce platforms. So with that said, I want to dive into one specific research project we did, and this is a really particular case of considering different forms of ratings, different rating scores, and how they work in effect across platform boundaries. So I will dive in really into the details and into some quite technical details as well of these of this study, but hopefully we can widen the picture again in the general discussion then. So just a brief overview, a few short words on online reputation in general and some related work in that topic. And then I really want to dive into the results of this particular study here. Well, I don't really have to tell you, I guess, that reputation is, and trust in particular, is really important in online settings, since you get to transact with mostly strangers, with people that you haven't met before, and of course there is some sort of difficulty in enforcing the law online if you encounter some problems, right? So imagine the case you're booking some accommodation via an online platform and show up on site and the house isn't there, or the host isn't there. So it's really tricky to circle around these issues here. So trust and based on this reputation is really an important issue and an important thing to have in online settings. And this is also well reflected in the fact that having ratings and having reviews is really associated with increased demand for online sellers, for online providers, and increased levels of trustworthiness. So this online reputation, be it in the form of reviews or stars or rating scores or whatever, it really pays off economically. That has been shown over and over again over the last 20 years, starting off with eBay ratings. But this is even more true for all these sharing economy platforms, which bring together consumers basically. And so reputation is a really important factor economically as well. And this basically gives rise to the question whether, since many people are working or transacting or using many platforms today and build up reputation on these platforms differently, whether they can make use of the reputation they build up in one context also in other contexts, right? Because as it works today is that mostly all platforms, or actually all platforms, function in silos where there is no interconnection between those platforms for the most part. So the question is, if you have been active as an eBay seller for many years and have built up a really good reputation for delivering on time and delivering high quality products, and you simply want to start, for instance, renting out a room on Airbnb, or even want to book a room through a platform like Airbnb, and you just have signed up on the platform and you're basically a black horse on this new platform. So you may face a hard time in getting accepted as a guest or even attracting demand as a host. So the question here is whether you can actually make use of the reputation you earned in one context and simply transfer it to another context. And if it's possible, whether in the process something may be lost. And this is the particular scenario we focused in, right? And then, of course, this brings up other questions, whether, for instance, when, eBay and Airbnb are not really competing in the same market area, but consider cases like eBay and Airbnb and Vimdu or other accommodation sharing platforms, where there may arise tension between porting data between these platforms, since they are competing against each other. So the main question here is, how does reputation transfer between platforms, and specifically, does the presence of a numerical rating, a star rating here, and the respective values of these ratings that are present on the target platform and on the source platform, how are these values associated with the user's trustworthiness on these platforms? And the fact is that we're looking at ratings that are being ported from one platform to the other. So the entire idea of aggregating or transporting reputational data between platforms is not entirely new. Already back in 2012, and at least Martin will, of course, remember this gold digger time in the platform and sharing economy, there were many ideas of making use of reputational data online. However, most of the services and aggregator startups that started out to do this, just a couple of names here, have in the meanwhile gone out of business. So it seems to be a really tricky business to at least for third-party aggregators to manage this sort of reputational transfers. So the case that we are looking, that we've been looking at in the study, is the direct import between platforms. So the direct connection of platforms in this sense. Deemley and Traity have been active most recently. I think Deemley has already gone out of business. And Traity is another third party aggregator service that still tries to create these online reputational passports where you link up your Traity account with your platform accounts, and they provide, as shown here, something like this reputational online passport where all your different rating scores from the different sources are aggregated. And then there's this particular interesting case of Bonanza.com. And Bonanza is an e-commerce platform very similar to eBay, basically. It's operating mainly in the US, maybe even exclusively in the US. It's a home for mostly professional, but also private sellers of goods of any type, just like eBay. And what they offer on their platform is that if you sign up anew here, just like I did with my test account on Bonanza, and you're not having any reputational data nor ratings yet, you can actually import this data from eBay if you have an eBay account, and also if you have good enough eyesight to discover this little import function here. So what happens then, if you click on that, you're guided through this process where you provide your credentials for your eBay profile to verify your account, and then it's a matter of a minute or two, and you end up having imported your reputation on Bonanza as well. In my case, quite impressive, two five-star reviews that are being imported here, so I can start off my career as a power seller on Bonanza now. So, but this really shows that there are some cases that actually make these imports a reality, although they are not really well known, I would say, and I think they are also not that frequent. Beyond Bonanza, there's another platform called TrueGather who does that very similarly, also importing ratings from Amazon. So this really targets professional sellers mostly. So, but these are, at least to the best of my knowledge, the only examples that exist in the market that actually make reputation transfers a reality in this sense already. And most other platforms basically work in silos, which of course has also something to do with the competitive strategy they have, right? Because the reputation data the users gather on their platform, it's a strategic advantage. It creates some sort of informational lock-in where it's really hard to switch to other platforms. And this is, of course, what is criticized by the EU and other bodies, that this lock-in effect, which arises due to reputation on the data, on the platforms, hinders competition, or at least fair and free competition between platforms. So I won't talk much about the related work and the literature that has been done, since the particular use cases that actually compared transferring reputational data from one platform to the other are quite scarce if you only focus on cases where specific rating scores have been considered. And in most cases, as shown here, only 5-star ratings have been considered. So, I mean, why should anyone import something, any other rating than a 5-star rating, right? And what has been shown in prior studies is that transporting this rating or these ratings, these excellent ratings, actually has a positive effect even across platform boundaries. So consider you're taking your eBay rating with you to Airbnb, and what has been shown a couple of times now in a couple of studies is that if the rating is good enough, it will have a positive effect on the perceived trustworthiness or your trustworthiness in the eyes of potential customers on different platforms. And it works, of course, if the source platform, so the platform where you're taking the reputation from, has a high quality in itself or high reputation in itself, and also if the fit between platforms is high. So transporting in, maybe within the same context of mobility or accommodation sharing will work better than transferring ratings across context, which is not that surprising. So what hasn't been done, and which is what we have been doing in this study, is looking at specific rating scores. So is it basically the question, is it actually worth to import a 4-star rating or a 3-star rating, given the scenario that you don't have any rating yet or that you already have a 5-star rating on the target platform, and comparing all these different cases of values that the reputation can have. So the main premise here is that the complementers or users' trustworthiness on a given platform is actually driven both by the reputation they have earned on the platform itself, the on-site reputation, and also by the reputation they may import from another platform. We conceptualized this quite standard way, I would say, where ratings range from 1 to 5 stars, which is the most common scheme that we observe in the market. And this actually then gives rise to 4 conceptual cases, where in the first case, no rating is present whatsoever, neither on the target platform nor anything to import it. Then there may be an on-site rating only, where you already have a rating on the new platform, but don't import anything. You may be new on this new platform here, don't have gathered any reputation there yet, but import a rating from somewhere else of value RI. And in the last case, simply both happens, you already have a rating here and also import a rating from the other platform. Right? So this is the space we're talking about. And we are modeling the effect of rating scores as linear effects, as linear partial effects, where better ratings will linear increase the trustworthiness you have on the platform. This is the model we assume. And we also allow for these ratings to interact with each other. Right? And what this means technically, and I won't spend too much time on this, is that the reputation or the trustworthiness you have on in this context will depend on the different rating scores, RE and RI, you have earned already. And this has to be distinguished across these 4 cases. And this is basically the economic model we then in the next step test by means of an experiment and gather the data to estimate the model parameters here. So this already opens up a quite interesting opportunity here, because it allows us to talk about when it is actually worth importing a rating or not. And given that, for instance, on the left side here, you don't have any rating yet, you simply can compare these cases and see and equate these levels of trustworthiness you have between these cases, right? And this leads directly to a solution for the import threshold you have to overcome in terms of the model parameters in order to actually import a rating to your own benefit. And the same is true for the more complex case where you already have a rating on the Entrant platform. And now the threshold, as you can see here, will depend on this rating score. But I guess I will show what this means in terms of results in a minute. So what we did to estimate this model and estimate the parameters is a scenario-based online experiment where we created this vignette, having people put themselves in this situation and simply evaluate different cases where the hypothetical user had either reputation on the one, on the other platforms, platform, and these ratings had different values, right? So this is how this looked, a really stylized scenario, of course. And as you can see here in this case, there was some 4-star rating present on the platform already, and a 5-star rating was imported from another platform, Airbnb in this case. Right. And this is the treatment structure, all the different cases with different values we used here in steps of 0.5 stars. And also, of course, the cases where no reputation was present. And well, in terms of results, we see that in this first case, this is basically only the average, there emerges a trustworthiness level of 0.35 on a scale from 0 to 1, which doesn't really say much if you don't compare it to other cases, but it becomes interesting if you compare it to other cases, right? For instance, consider the third case here, where you only have the imported rating, which then leads to these model estimates, where the trustworthiness you experience is linear, dependent on the imported rating score, right? And what this means is basically that there emerges this intersection where around a value of 3 stars, it becomes beneficial to import this this rating from another platform compared to the case where you don't have any rating on the platform yet, right? So we have this first threshold basically to say something about when it is actually worth to import a rating. And this is a little bit surprising already, since given this whole positivity bias and rating inflation that has been going on for a couple of years, that now in general ratings tend to be really good and in the area of 4 to 5 stars, that already a 3-star rating may be enough, although not much in this case, to give you some leverage here to increase your trustworthiness in this scenario. All right, let's move on. It gets a little more tricky here, where you compare the next case when you already have earned reputation on the target platform. And unsurprisingly, there's a positive effect. The better the rating you have, the higher your reputation or the trustworthiness you experience. And let's compare this now to this fourth case where you have both on-site and imported ratings, and also allowing for this interaction. And as you can see here, there is a statistical interaction. So these rating scores tend to work together well if both are high, right? They are reinforcing basically mutually. And what this means for this chart is that depending on the imported score and depending on the on-site rating you already have, they emerge different import thresholds, right? And as you can see here, this is basically the same chart, just putting it all together. They emerge these red diamonds, which given the to be imported rating comes up with a different threshold of when it should be imported. And I guess if you pin it down in this two-dimensional chart where you have the on-site rating score on one axis and the to be imported rating score on the other, you really see that there is this area where it's not worth importing it, since the on-site score is already high enough given the level of the to be imported score. Whereas on the other half here, it's already a good idea to import the rating score, right? Since the score is high enough, or the on-site score you already have is not high enough. So so there is this decision boundary, this tactical decision boundary, given that you already have reputation on the platform and you have a certain score of value X, when should it be imported and when shouldn't it be imported? And it's not a trivial situation anymore. And it really depends on how these scores interact in the eyes of potential customers. And this is what we try to show here. So this is maybe helpful for you as a user to decide whether to import the rating or not. Well, that's just the first result basically in this sense. And of course there remain a lot of technical, economic, regulatory questions that need to be discussed here and that are still also subject to an ongoing debate. For instance, the mechanisms of importing. We haven't really said much about this. We really simply assumed there is this direct import as created in the scenario. But of course, there are different scenarios conceivable, right? Where there are these third-party aggregators, and it's not clear which approach will prevail. My assumption here is, or my gut feeling actually, is that these third-party services seem to struggle a lot, since it's yet another service you have to sign up for, have to create an account, have to possibly provide credentials and sensitive information. And since in a way it's also a platform, a two-sided platform that has to be attractive for customers and also for platforms to sign up, it has all these typical issues of starting off, and this chicken and egg problem of attracting customers and attracting platforms at the same time. So I think third-party services will have a hard time solving this. And my gut feeling is that direct imports between platforms, so bilateral collaborations between platforms that decide to maybe mutually share this data, may be more promising in this regard. Of course, regulation is a big thing here. GDPR and CCPA, of course, in the EU and California have set out to somehow address this issue of data portability. In particular, Article 20, of course, of GDPR speaks about data portability. However, it doesn't really refer to reputational data, since it only refers to data that only the users themselves have provided or uploaded to the platform, which is by definition not the case for reputational data. So it's not entirely clear. Most legal scholars I've talked to would agree that it's not part of the regulation yet. However, the intention of the regulation was to address this topic, although they mostly had Facebook in mind. But the intention was to break monopolies and increase competition. And in the sense, it may actually be conceivable that the regulation is updated in some future point of time. So we will see about that. And of course, it's a matter of competitive strategy, right, for platforms to decide whether to create these import or export functions. And in a way, we have this typical prisoner's dilemma situation here, where, of course, all the platforms maybe would want to import reputational data from other platforms, since this way they can help their users to start off. However, no one really wants to give away this reputational data. So we may end up in this deadlock situation where simply all the platforms want to be on the receiving end, but not want to free this reputation data as well. And then, of course, there's the question which sort of reputational data should be shared or would work most effectively. We've been looking mostly at numerical scores, so these star rating scores, but other forms of reputation are, of course, conceivable as well, in particular text reviews. Which also gives rise to additional problems, right? Because with text reviews, you have an additional actor in the game, which is the author, who usually has some property rights on this text. So it gets a little bit more complicated, but I guess it's nothing that can't be solved really by terms and conditions of platforms. And we will see how this turns out in the end. So I think I'm running out of time. This is just a little overview of the research we've been doing in this area over the last 2-3 years, basically. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm really looking forward to questions and the discussion ahead. Thanks.
Okay, perfect, Tim. Thank you very much for the contribution. It's really nice to see the research from a academic perspective, and also what you can learn from e-commerce platforms. I really like it. So, by the way, everybody will also share the slides. So you will receive a mail from Lisa somewhere at the end of the week with the PDFs of the slides of everybody that's presented, and also with some links to the researchers that are being presented. So that's something you will receive at a later moment. Okay, thank you, Tim. I think we can do the questions in the second part, because we're also having a quite interesting time schedule today. So thank you for your contribution. And now I would like to give the floor to Jeroen. Yeah, I already introduced Jeroen. He's based in the east of Netherlands. I'm based in the center of Netherlands, and we also did quite some work together on this topic. And we're going to do some other stuff later on, which I will share after the break. So Jeroen, it's the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Martijn. Can you see my slides? Excellent. Perfect. Well, first of all, thanks for having me here, and also for attending this session. And a special thanks to Martijn, also to the JobTech Development Initiative and the GigLab Zweden for giving me the opportunity to present some of the research that I'm doing. As Martijn said, I'm working at the University of Twente. It's in the eastern part of the Netherlands, so on the right-hand side of this picture, it's the part of the Netherlands that doesn't flood when the dikes break. Just to let you know, Twente is not a city, but it's a region that has its own university. University of Twente is a technical university, but it also has a strong, there's also a faculty that does social science research, and that's where I am located. I'm based within the Human Resource Management Research Group. And within this group, we study human resource management at the interface of technology and innovation. So on one hand, I have colleagues that examine the relationship between HRM and the innovation performance of organizations and how HRM activities can be used to stimulate workers' innovative working behaviors. And on the other hand, we also examine how HRM is being impacted by technological developments such as artificial intelligence, HR analytics, or the use of algorithms in HRM. And that's also where my research is located. Broadly speaking, I do research into human resource management in the platform economy, and more specifically, the HR management of gig workers. As you can see, I also do some gig work myself for research purposes. I have delivered food for both Uber Eats and Deliveroo in Amsterdam and also in Enschede, where I am located, to study how platform workers are being managed and how the relationship between platform workers and platforms that they work for is organized. Besides that, I have a special interest in the use of algorithms for augmenting and or automating managerial activities on platforms such as Uber and Deliveroo. And these algorithmic management systems are also fed with data coming from customers or companies that request services from gig workers, and that's where online reputation systems kick in. And this also brings me to the research results that I want to share with you today. We conducted an exploratory study into the portability of reputation data. And as a matter of fact, this study was also greatly inspired by the work that Tim Teubner presented to you earlier. And what we wanted to know on the basis also of Tim's research is, how do platform representatives or managers of these platforms, but also workers and consumers that make use of such platforms, how do they look at reputation transfer and the portability of reputational data? And more specifically, we wanted to explore what types of reputational data transfer that the platform stakeholders did see most utility in, and also under which conditions they were either willing or unwilling to share reputational data and to transfer reputational data. And also in the case of workers, under which conditions they would be willing to make sure of reputation transfer systems. And how did we do this? We conducted interviews with representatives, managers, workers, and requesters coming from 9 online labor platforms that are operating in the Netherlands. If you want to, I can also tell you later what were these online platforms. But these were primarily online labor platforms that matchmake workers and requesters for on-location work. So that's food delivery, cleaning, or restaurant chefs that that offer their freelance services to restaurants. So this research excluded more crowd-based platforms where work activities are taking place online. And I said that we conducted this research because I didn't do this alone. There were three graduate students from the University of Twente who were also involved in collecting the data and analyzing the data. And their names also should be mentioned. They are Marco Rotus, Dennis Neisink, and Lars de Aves. So it's sort of the results that I'm presenting you today is really a shared or is a result of a shared and joint collaboration. And what we were actually interested in, let me just go back to the other slide for a second. So we were interested in the what one could call the how, what, who, and why of portability of reputation data. So let's first start off with the what, the why. Tim also touched upon this to some extent, and we saw three reasons why different platform users would be willing to share and transfer reputational data and to make use of such schemes. So first of all, is to overcome the newbie dilemma. So the newbie dilemma occurs when a platform worker wants to join a platform but doesn't have a reputational score yet on that platform. It could, if such newbies were to transfer their reputation from an incumbent platform where they have built an online reputation to the target platform, then it would be more easy for them also to land more jobs on that platform. So this, so through reputation transfer, this newbie effect could be overcome. Secondly, another reason why platform workers wanted to make use of this scheme is to be able to engage in multi-homing. So to work for multiple platforms at the same time, and this obviously becomes more easy if you can also transfer your reputational data from one platform to the other, such that you can work on two platforms. And relating back to what Tim said earlier about this prisoner's dilemma, especially newcomer platforms that still wanted to grow their online marketplace, these platforms were particularly in favor of reputation transfer because it more easily helps to scale up their online marketplace if newcomers on this marketplace could take their online reputation from another platform. So these were, generally speaking, the three most common reasons that we came across in our research why different platform stakeholders were interested in reputation transfer. Now the what. As you can see here, I took a print screen of an online profile coming from the Hi Guide platform. That's a platform which is located in Enschede, so in Twente, where I come from. And the Hi Guide platform match makes between tour guides and tourists in cities all across the world. And on the basis of this screenshot, I want to walk you through what can be transferred from one platform to the other. So first of all, some interviewees were very much in favor of sharing and transferring written reviews because they told that this made it much more easy for them to select workers. So it were primarily consumers on these platforms that were most in favor of having written reviews being transferred from one platform to another. Others were very much in favor of sharing rating schemes like these five-star rating schemes, which you can see here, but also thumbs up, thumbs down rating schemes. There was, however, a big downside to transferring such rating schemes. First of all, we know from research that these rating schemes can be heavily biased, like racial biases that creep in when ratings are provided. Sometimes workers cannot do anything to avoid getting a low review. For instance, a Uber taxi driver that gets stuck in a traffic jam and the customer gets upset that he or she arrives too late at her final destination and therefore gives her a low rating to the Uber driver. And also we know, on the other hand, these online rating schemes are heavily inflated. So these rating schemes tend to be strongly skewed to the right, where the majority of reviews are either a 4 or 5 star rating that are being offered. And also there was an issue related to the number of repeated transactions, because there are also multiple platforms where a worker is doing a lot of, or is engaging in a lot of work assignments for an individual client that only gets reviewed once. So for instance, a chef that is working in a restaurant, the chef is often only evaluated after the first assignment, but not when doing a second, third or fourth assignment for the same restaurant. So having said this, it could make more sense to also to share reputational data on either the number of reviews which are given, but also the number of gigs or work assignments that a worker has executed in the past. And there are some benefits to this. For instance, research by Vili Lidon-Dirta from Oxford University and colleagues has shown that actually the number of gigs completed is much more strongly related to the earnings of a worker in comparison to the ratings, this 5-star ratings that they have. So one could also make a plea for also transferring data other than data which is related to ratings, but also like number of gigs which are performed. On the other hand, there are also some downsides to this approach. Especially, a big downside could be that there is a reduced utility in case of long-term assignments, because the longer the assignment takes, the lower the number of gigs that a worker can complete. So it's probably a mixture of different data points and parameters that have to be shared across platforms. And on top of this, some interviewees also said, well, we can also, for instance, think of sharing the data about the time that workers spend working on gigs in order to also offset the problems that are associated to sharing data about the number of gigs that workers complete. Then also another question related to what is, what actually should be transferred? Is it statistics like averages, or really the raw data about selected work activities that a worker performed, and for instance, the duration of those gigs and the rating that these workers received. And there were different pros and cons to this, and there was not like one unified opinion coming from the interviewees about whether raw data should be shared or whether statistics should be shared. And as a caution, I would advise to always make sure that you also share the measurement instrument by which these data were generated. And why is that the case? Because it's also important to estimate whether the reputations which are transferred are actually reliable. You're looking at a screenshot that I found on the internet of the Uber app, where the customer is asked to rate a trip with Abdel Latif. And the question is, to me as a researcher, what is actually being evaluated here? Is it the trip or is it the driver or both? And it's very hard to get a finger on this. But if you were to import such data from one platform to the other, we might run the risk of not knowing what is actually measured. So we don't know what reputation we're actually talking about. Irrespectively of what you share and how you share, is always, I would say, it's always important also to take in mind which measurement instrument was used. And this brings me to another point, and it's the notion of source target fit, which Tim has also studied. Intuitively, it would make most sense to share reputational data across platforms that are in the same industry, for instance, Uber and Lyft and Bolt, sharing their reputational data, because then we can at least assume that what is evaluated and what type of performance is evaluated is more or less similar across platforms. But then there are competitive dynamics and also this prisoner's dilemma that Tim was talking about earlier that come into play. And I have been thinking about what could be an initial solution to this issue. And for this, we could turn to the literature on performance management, which says that there are actually three things that can be evaluated about a worker. So we have to ask the question, which performance metrics can we use? What data does it generate that we can transfer? And that could also help to overcome this prisoner's dilemma. So we could, for instance, think of sharing data about worker attributes, like personality traits. And to share such data about whether a worker is extroverted or agreeable does not necessarily have to come from platforms that are operating in a similar industry. Because across, if a gig worker is working in different industries, then his or her personality traits still remain the same. So in this way, personality traits or data about personality traits could be transferred from one platform to the other without creating this prisoner's dilemma problem. A second performance dimension, so to speak, that could be measured and is identified in the literature of worker behaviors. So things which they actually do, whether they are polite, for instance, whether they are interested, or as you can see on this picture, whether they are paying attention or not. And platforms also collect data about worker behaviors, not necessarily about whether they pay attention, but they do collect data coming from customers about whether platform workers are considered to be hospitable, for instance. And then finally, we could also think of sharing data about outcomes of worker behavior, for instance, whether they are productive or not, or whether customers are satisfied with the service that is provided. So depending on what type of data is shared, we could also overcome these competitive dynamics that prevent platforms from sharing data with one another. Getting to the close of this presentation, we also ask questions about who of data portability and also how. Well, we came across two main ways how data can be shared. So on the one hand, bilaterally, like Uber and Lyft bilaterally sharing data with one another, and through a third party, like the job tech development. And when third parties are involved, another question that comes to mind is, what is the role of this third party? Is this like a standalone platform, so to speak, or a meta platform, like a platform which sole purpose is to enable reputation transfer? Or is this more of a one-stop shop or meta platform that does more for platform workers than just transferring reputational data? And an example of a one-stop shop or meta platform is, for instance, a platform that doesn't only facilitate workers to transfer their data to other platforms, but also that does payroll administration for them, that offers social security benefits, or that provides them with insurance services. And then finally, relating to the who, we oftentimes came across workers who did not really see the need for reputational data because they were okay with working for one platform and they didn't feel the need to work for a second platform or to engage in multi-homing. And to my knowledge, there was no systematic literature or no systematic research done into the need that platform workers experience for reputation transfer systems. So that's still a big question that remains unanswered. Also, we came across issues related to the rights of workers. After all, they are also could be considered the owners of the data that is generated about their performance. So then the question is, should it be platforms that transfer data, or should this be a right of workers to decide themselves whether they want to transfer their data or not? But this creates another problem or another issue, which relates to social or competitive pressures to transfer data. Because even when platforms decide to share data, but leave the choice for workers to take their data from one platform to the other, such workers might feel pressured to actually do this, whereas in reality, they don't want to do this because they might be afraid that they will be outcompeted by workers who do transfer their reputational data from one platform to the other. And then finally, and therefore some workers did not feel that much for between platform transfer, where platforms bilaterally or through a third party share reputational data. And instead, these workers opted for being able to include their reputational data into their CV or into a competence passport. So this is also a question: how do we want to transfer data through this competence passport or certified platform evaluations, or through or by means of between platform transfer? Let me just see how I'm doing with regards to time. Yeah, it's almost time to wrap up. So we also asked requesters about whether they see the need and utility of data portability. And as academics usually say, it depends, and it also applies. It applies here because there were also many instances where requesters, which are either individual consumers or businesses that want to hire gig workers, did not see the need for data portability. For instance, when requesters have very little autonomy in selecting which workers they want to work with, they didn't see the need for data portability. And this would apply, for instance, in cases of platforms like Uber or Deliveroo, where you more or less get where you as a requester get a gig worker assigned to you, and you only have the option to reject, so to speak, this worker, but you don't have that much autonomy and leeway to choose yourself which platform worker you want to work with. Same goes for the duration of assignments. When assignments are super short and are not strategically important to an organization, oftentimes, requesters also did not see the use of data portability, and they would just hire or work with the platform worker that was assigned to them by the platform. And also, it depends on the level of demandness, as I would call it, whether requesters saw the need for the utility of data portability. And this means in cases where requesters would want to hire a gig worker just now, then oftentimes they were also okay with just being assigned a platform worker rather than having go through multiple profiles and look into the reputational data of a worker to hire the worker. So in such cases, from the perspective of consumers or hiring organizations, reputation transfer might not necessarily be that necessary. So having said this, I want to thank you for again joining and listening to my presentation. And having said this, I would like to hand back the word to you, Martijn.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jeroen, for your insightful presentations. Really nice to see some firsthand insights from the stakeholders we are talking about that we're also now talking with them. And I think it's also really showed the complexity of this whole system, because there are quite some differences because the gig economy doesn't exists, like also not the labor market or the economy. So you also saw the the difference between like the more on-demand and more scheduled platforms, like where with on-demand platforms like food delivery and taxi, the reputation system is more a kind of a outsourcing of HR to the clients. And while with the more planned transaction, where also the customer really needs to pick somebody out of, let's say 10, then the reputation tool as a completely different role in the transaction. And, if, and I think also what's also really good about your presentation, it really also made us aware of how careful we need to be with the decisions we make. Because we all know the rating systems, they are far from perfect. They are quite imperfect. And at the moment that we're going to bundle them and also institutionalize them, then it all will also not be an option, because then it will be just the defaults. And it's really, it comes with great responsibility if you start things with putting a default in society. Because, yeah, then you start with one thing and then in the end it will be much more. So I think it's really, good to be really aware about the responsibility also by building these kind of systems of how to set new defaults and also which kind of data to include and which kind of data just leave at the platform, because we all know they're not perfect. There's also one question from Thomas. He asked in the chat, what about the rating validity? Are the platform validating the source of the rating so no fake ratings are obtained? Jeroen, is there something, because it's appeared on your presentation, is there something you can say about?
Well, I can try. We know from newspaper articles that, for instance, within the Netherlands, the takeaway.com platform, Thuisbezorgd platform, also allows workers to get negative reviews taken off their platform if they want to give a financial reimbursement for this. But going back to what I presented earlier, I think it would make most sense to first try and share more objective data rather than subjective data coming from customers, like the number of gigs completed. On the other hand, we also have to be cautious about this. So I don't have a ready-made answer to this question, but there is research coming from Mohamed Jarari from the United States, who did research into, I believe it's the Upwork or Fiverr platform, where gig workers also try to game this system where objective data was collected. So platforms also register how many gigs these workers completed. But these gig workers ask their clients to break down long-term gigs into smaller gigs in order to ultimately ramp up the number of gigs that they completed. So even if we are to share more objective data, and I always put them between quotes because they're not that objective as they might appear.
It's interesting size net, and in the end, of course, there's also not really transparent on how the platforms are calculating the average star rating scores. With some platforms, you can as a super user, you can remove one negative review a month. But also, like with Uber, we all know that people in the US are more likely to give a 5-star rating than in the Netherlands, because especially in the Netherlands, we're quite conservative. We're really direct and conservative in this. We're not really good in saying you're awesome, and that's they're really good in that in the US. So also in their average scores, they're also having a different formula in how to calculate the average score. And also as a Uber driver, when somebody gives you a 1-star rating and then says, okay, but in the comments something about it took too long or something like that, then this score isn't calculated in the average, because then it's possibly something that is out of control of the driver. So platforms are, from various reasons, positive and negative, not really clear in how to calculate this average score. And this is, of course, also really a question when you are going to bundle them. So that's I think lots of questions, but I think this also really makes it a really interesting subject. So thanks, Jeroen, for your contribution. We are now going to have a short break. It's be back at 10:55, so in 8 minutes. So you can stretch your legs and maybe get a coffee, dance, whatever you want. After that, I will share some really practical insights on my research and also about a workshop we did in Netherlands with 13 gig platforms on these questions. And also, we're also going to start an experiment right now. And I'm also going to share some insights on that. And after that, we also have a kind of a workshop based on some questions. And then everybody is being divided in different groups. And then we can have some more discussion in smaller teams. If you have any questions in between, just put them in the chats.
I was asking, can I put a real question, or do you want me to put it in the chat?
Oh, yes, you can also have a real question. Yes, that's also possible. So what's your question?
And help me here. I might be totally wrong, but you're talking about reputational data, and you're talking about data that we can use to validate the sort of level of service we can expect. And I mean, this is data that we up to now have used both from a consumer perspective, but we've also used it from a platform perspective to sort of validate that the self-employed or the whatever it is that are attached to the platform live up to a certain level. Now, at the same time, we can see that kind of rating systems is giving weight in parallel ongoing discussion about reclassification of platform workers. And therefore, if this continues, I would expect that platforms would be less inclined to invest in good rating systems because this could tie them to being actual employers. Does any one of you see this as a risk for the future of reputational data in a longer perspective? Not a short question, and I apologize for that.
No problem for that. I think it's a really good question because in the end, of course, the nice thing about the discussion is that it's for one time not a discussion on classification, but on other subjects. From a Dutch perspective, because I'm also not a lawyer, what we see is that this doesn't have any influence on the discussion, because it's also used by as well platforms using a freelancer as a supply, as a platform that's using a temp agency model as a supply. But there are some questions also from a temp agency perspective, because in the end, freelance platforms, they don't want to allocate because then they are a temp agency. So they are trying to not do anything that can lead them to discussion of allocation. But at the other side, the temp agency platforms, as a temp agency, you get a kind of a duty of doing well for your worker. that's also why the process is really quite big. But then the question is, when temp agencies are going to start platforms with these kind of metrics, are they able to be a good employer when the only thing they do is facilitating with a platform and technology to bring together this demand and supply? So there are quite some questions around these different issues. As far as I know, there's no discussion on the portability of the reputation data compared to the discussion of the status of the supplier, the worker of the platform. But that's of course maybe something that can also depends per country how legislation is formed.
Perhaps add?
Yes, please.
So I think it's a very important and interesting question, David, if I may. I just showed you those two pictures where I delivered meals for Uber Eats and Deliveroo, and one of the reasons why I did this is also to get a better understanding of how platforms try to balance, on the one hand, controlling workers to make their business model work, but also leaving them the freedom as a like a paradoxical situation. And together with Anne Keegan, who is also here with us today, and Tanya Bonderhoek, we're working on a research paper where we also explain how platforms do this. And one of the ways how they try to balance these tensions and to address these paradoxes is by devolving or outsourcing HRM activities to requesters. And one of the things which they obviously outsource is performance appraisal by means of these online rating schemes. So rather than collecting objective data, it would make much more sense for them to even further devolve the collection of reputational data to customers. And there could be a second reason why platforms might, or not a second reason, but a reason why platforms might be hesitant to share reputational data, because if this comes into the hands of those who are able to reverse engineer their algorithmic management system by means of these reputational data, then this would also bring more insight into the control system that these platforms use, which then can be also inputted into reclassification lawsuits. So this whole notion of workers being treated as falsely self-employed in these high-profile court cases that we see coming up around the world could even be a reason for platforms not to engage in transferring data, and could also explain why they might be neutral with regards to reputational data, as Martijn showed earlier.
Yeah, after Rick, I will also show an example where Uber is already sharing some of the data, and I think what you mentioned, Jeroen, is really important, but I think that's really applies on platforms with a on-demand small transaction, like Uber, Deliveroo, Bolt, and not with the platforms that are more also in the to-business markets that are more the planned transactions, because the on-demand platform, they really use the reputation score and systems to outsource HR, and that's a different case with the more planned transaction platforms. So we're going to have a discussion also about that that's after the break. So Dave, thanks also for your question, also in not only in chat but also in real life on video. As you guess, we're now going to have a small break till 11. So get some coffee, stand up, walk around, so that also gets you some new energy. And then I will also share some information. And then we're also going to have some nice discussion on the different, because there are lots of questions, which is really, really good. So I'll see you at 11. Because in the end, with e-commerce, it doesn't really matter if you're selling pens or cups. In the end, it's about the experience and the you have as a seller, and how you deal with transportation, with customer service, this kind of stuff. With gig economy, it's I guess a lot harder, because you like being a good Uber driver doesn't say anything of if you also are a good home cleaner. For just some example, I also had quite some discussions with more ethical designers of technology. And what I saw is that when I used the word reputation transfer, there were lots of questions and concerns. But in the end, it's also about the transfer of validated transactions. So how many gigs did you did? Or also, like you, Jeroen also mentioned, okay, how many hours did you work for these kind of gigs? And also, what kind of skills did you then used for that? So the question is reputation data transfer also a right framing in the debate? Because I see, especially with more the ethical and social designers, they are really scared about this this word about reputation transfer, and then also thinking a lot about the whole China issue. Just a question. Also a question. Does portability make also the gap between workers and non-workers bigger? Because, like as well, Tim as Jeroen mentions about the newbie dilemma. So people that start working at a platform with no reputation. But also but there are also newbies without any reputation or experience on other platforms. So maybe it's also possible that this reputation portability also makes the gap between people without experience and people with experience even bigger, because it's easier to have experience on platforms at the moment that you already work for platforms, but then it's harder to enter. So maybe the newbie dilemma will only be bigger when you start transferring that. So I think it's also important to keep in mind. So if you look at also the research I did now for the last 10 months, I did quite some interviews with many people, but also the previous years, I also did quite some interviews with the founders of different reputation portability startups. So like Tim and Jeroen also mentioned, most of them are, or I think all of them are dead now. But you can learn a lot about what they did. And you can also use the waybackmachine.org, because then websites that are offline right now, you can see what they showed a couple of years ago. It's really interesting to just browse over there. So I'm also here some examples. So Trust Cloud, Deeply Trade, E-Rated. These are all now non-existing startups anymore. Albert also mentioned in the comments that Traity is not existing anymore. Deeply is also not here anymore. And Trust Cloud and E-Rated, there are more, I think, from a couple of years ago. I think Trust Cloud was one of the first based in New York. They also had really complex systems on how to measure this reputation. I think Trust Cloud was doing a really interesting fun experiment about combining behavioral endorsement and transactional data in one score. You will get the slides after the presentation, of course. Also, this is Traity. And also, combine different sources, like also your Facebook and LinkedIn data, identity and recommendation also from other friends. And then also was question, okay, and then the business model, because startups, they also need to make money, of course, only to pay the bills. And this is an example of Straighty, where they use the reputation data as an indication of how trustworthy you are. And then when you are going to rent a house, you only need to pay $250 instead of $2,000 upfront because your score probably showed that you are a trustworthy person. This is a picture of Deeply when they were online, and of course also the initiatives from Sweden. I think it's really interesting to look at that. Okay, so see, it's all the different kind of initiatives. So what are the pitfalls? I think one of them is they really took a single stakeholder approach. So they didn't really attract different stakeholders like other platforms and platform workers, but also other institutions like the employment services in the approach. In the end, the end goal, but also related to the business model, was also really complex. So the end goal was credit scores. So give people more access to financial markets, which is really interesting fun experiment, but in the end, it's really hard to make it work. So you really need lots of time and money to make it happen. It's really a really long shot. They also not really making choices. So all peer-to-peer platforms were included. So they didn't focus on one specific niche. International approach. And it's really hard to build a trusted network within countries. And also the business model and also the continuity of the data wasn't guaranteed. I think what Traity did was really interesting, because they also say, okay, we also have a parallel transaction fee on the blockchain. So when we go offline, then the data is secured somewhere else. But that's really, really rare. So some requirements for success. I think, keep it simple, or at least start simple and make speeds, because you can make it really complex, but complexity is also not really a good thing to make things work. So start simple. Do a multi-stakeholder approach and also a broad recognition of added value. So also ask like temp agencies, okay, do you also accept this kind of data? And also, do you also acknowledge this has value for the candidates, and also use a strong brand in that. Choose a clear niche. So what I'm now focusing on are gig platforms in Netherlands. Use open standards and technology so that others also can adopt it really, really fast. Independence, I think it's really important also for the trustworthiness of the initiative, and also find a way to secure the data and also the continuity. Because in the end, if this reputation data will be at least as important as your diploma, you don't want the data to disappear, because it's really important for you to have the data, also to have access to labor market. And of course, there are quite some questions left. So the first question is, should we ditch the stars? Just to ask a really important one. Because also what you also saw at the other presentations, there are quite some questions about, okay, what is the use of the stars? And of course, it's fine that platforms are using the stars for their own processes, but at the moment that you are going to combine them, you're also institutionalizing all these not perfect working systems within the platform itself. So the question is, do you really need the stars for this portability? Yes or no? And I think I'm thinking now of a no. Because in the end, it's also more about validated transactions. So how much gigs did you did? What kind of skills did you used? And the stars don't really matter in that. Because in the end, like with Uber, you were never able to do 50 Uber rides if you only get one star for every ride. So the automatically system of the platforms already filters the good and the bad ones out of that. And also in the to-business market, like I mentioned before, I really expect these ratings will be much harder at the moment that like corporate companies are hiring people via platforms, let's say 20 people every day. And where there's also a divide between the people that hires them, like HR, and the people that looks on if the work is being executed well. So I see lots of problems with reputation systems where people really need to enter data inputs, where the client needs to enter data inputs about the reputation, about the quality of the work, when this more to business market will scale. Of course, a question: do people multi-home? Because it's nice to talk about portability, but if people are only working for one platform, then portability is a nice concept, but it doesn't add value. And of course, this is also a chicken egg problem, because maybe platform workers are only not multi-homing because they can't take their data with them. So, of course, this is also really important questions in that. Also, from simplicity to complex, which kind of decision do you make, and also how do you also make these steps in the future? If you're going to import data, how are you going to show this on the profile? It's also, of course, what Tim also addresses in his research on e-commerce platforms. We're also now talking about platforms to do the same experiments, but then on gig platforms to see also the impacts of this imported score on the transaction of a gig worker. How do you guarantee the continuity and the independence of this? So do you start a foundation, a data cooperative, or a blockchain? Also, where should it be secured? So who needs to be in control of this basic infrastructure? So it is a kind of a basic infrastructure that needs to be maintained by a employment service. So is it a really public infrastructure, or is it a something we need to think about that the market should fix it, or maybe a middleware like a cooperative? And also, do we also need to focus on the platform to platform, so the import and exports via a third party or direct import and exports, or also to a digital CV that give people more opportunities outside of the platform market? Because many platforms, they say, okay, we are really good for people to start in labor market, but then we can also use this data to help them also further in labor market, and not only in platform market, but also in labor markets in a broad sense. And there's a really interesting case on that. It's from Uber, and of course there are quite some interesting discussions on Uber. But what they are now doing in Netherlands, they publish a report, Eerlijk Werk, Fair Work. And one of the things they say, okay, we also have a recognition of good work. So they say, okay, we see that drivers, they are doing their best for our clients, and we also want to recognize it with something they can also use on the long term. So then what they did is, if they want to do the next step, like I frame it, or if you want to work at other ways and only as a driver at the Uber taxi platform, you can, in the app, you can request a PDF with a performance overview. And it gives you a recognition of the services you have provided via the Uber app. So what it says in practical part, it includes when you have done your first trip, so in which period you were active on the platform, how many trips you have been done, what is your average customer rating after last 500 trips, what are your three most important complements, and also a letter that also describes the skills you need when you are a taxi driver. So this you can just this is generated automatically when you push the button as a Dutch Uber taxi driver in the app. And then also, I think really important is this overview is also now recognized by a temp agency, in this case, Adecco. So Adecco, a Dutch temp agency, they built a landing page, especially for Uber drivers. It's in Dutch, of course. So it says, okay, well, welcome to the job portal of Uber and Adecco. And there they say, okay, we recognize this PDF exports of you. And they also, it is also in Dutch, of course, this also shows how you can download your recommendation letter from Uber in the app. So it's really interesting that they also found a temp agency that also say, okay, we are going to accept this letter of recommendation in the process of validating you if you are skilled for the job. So from that basic, we also had a workshop in the Netherlands. You see that picture over here. There were about 13 different gig platforms. So all relevant gig platforms in this market were there. Also really broad landscape of platforms. So like Uber and Deliveroo were there, but also the more temp agency platforms, also with freelance model, but also the home services platforms like Helpling and Charity Cares. They are providing babysitters for people at home. And we had a discussion about this subject about how to also realize this. And what's a temp agency? Question now. It's a temporary employment agency. So if you want to, are there other terms? Maybe somebody else can also give the Swedish version of.
Yeah, so we call it bemanningsföretag.
It sounds really nice. So because in Netherlands we see a really big growth of platforms active in the temp agency market, and I really believe it is also a really big market for gig platforms for the next years. So what are we now going to do? Now six Dutch gig platforms have expressed the ambition to build this system. So I am the initiator of this collaboration. They're not paying me because I don't want to be dependent and not want to work for them, because I think it's really important really to have an independent lead in this. So there's six Dutch platforms. They are now really coming together to talk about how to build this. I didn't include Uber and Deliveroo because their processes are really complex, because they are international organizations. The development isn't in Netherlands. Okay, for Uber it is, but it's they've got quite some formal processes, which doesn't really contribute to the speed of development. So they are connected to this initiative, but they're not one of the six platforms because their processes are only slowing down the processes, and I want to make speed in this. So what we're now looking is, okay, how can we export the validated gigs you did to a digital CV, but also how can we link the gigs you did to official skills, because then you get a letter of recommendation that says, okay, you have done this amount of gigs, or maybe even also what Jeroen suggested, hours worked, and these gigs represent this kind of skills you did. So then you can also match your skills also in the labor markets after that. And then we're also going to look for a portability system. So by that, I think first looking for a digital CV, and then look for the portability system. We're also going to do some research within this process, because I also forced the platforms also to work together on the research. And also together with Jeroen, we're going to do a really big questionnaire with, we hope to get at least 300 to 500 respondents from the gig workers, because we're also asking them via the platforms. And so they get access to their workers to see, okay, do they also want this reputation data portability system, and also what are their questions around it. And of course, there's also the chicken egg problem in that, but I think it's really important also to have the voice of the gig workers also included. But they're also talking about experiments with the in and export of reputation data. And I think, yeah, there are, of course, enough questions left. But in the end, yeah, I think it's really good just to start and build something and then learn from that. So that's the phase we are in here now in the Netherlands. Of course, there are lots of questions also from the platforms themselves, also on competition. And what I really was surprised on, the platforms with a temp agency background, they are really not so enthusiastic about sharing data. They're really talking about my candidates and my harvested data and I paid for it, so it's my data. And I really am experienced that the platforms, the gig platforms with non-temp agency backgrounds, they're much more open in sharing and they're really seeing themselves as facilitating the worker. Well, the temp agencies, they're really talking about owning the worker. So there's a really difference also in attitude and also openness to share between these kind of platforms, which was really, yeah, surprising and also confronting for me. Because in the end, my goal is, of course, if this works, then I can say to temp agencies, which is also a really big market, also in Netherlands, I can say, okay, the platforms can do it. You also got much data about the people that work for you. Come on. Lazy bastards, share your data. So it's also a way for me also to show, yeah, to point them at a responsibility to share data for the good of the worker. So that was my my presentation for this about the results. I see some hands clapping. Thank you very much. I don't know who clapped, but it's thanks for that. I will also share also in the email that will be sent by Lisa ook a report of the Dutch meeting. I see a question over here. By the way, you can also shout if you want to say, but I will read it up here. Do you think there are opportunities for data portability outside of the gig economy context? For example, many big employers now use standardized workforce management software like Kronos. Could data from this system be shared to new employers if they use the same system? Yeah, I think yes, that's possible. I think what we're now doing with the gig platform is just because it's really closed environments is to experiment. But in the end, of course, the more utopian scenario is to have a kind of a career wallet, a passport for work, where all your data about your experience, about maybe also about your reputation, your diplomas is secured. So in the end, you put all the data with the individual, which makes them much more flexible on labor markets. Of course, the question is also from a more broader perspective, more empowering this worker with this data will probably also lead to a much more flexible labor market, because it's because then the transaction cost of switching jobs or gigs or other hybrid forms are getting lower and lower, which also can have in conflict with the existing challenges we already have with the flexible labor market, because institutions are not designed for the flexibility. So then we also need to think about how to redesign the institutions for the flexibility, for the goods of the worker, and how to make sure that also all the public values and also all the securities are also implemented in a more flexible labor market. And it's like Netherlands, one of the main discussions now already for 10 years. So that's another much more broader question in that. If there are no, are there any questions left, or else we go to the workshop parts?
Rather a comment, maybe, if I may jump in.
Yes, please.
But first of all, thanks. That's really interesting insights. And regarding the 5-star rating scores, I totally agree that, of course, these may be really under complex in certain environments, especially when it comes to crowd work and where you as a potential future employer may be really interested in what did this guy, this worker specifically do, and does this really fit to the job description of the job I have at hand here? When it comes to importing this data, you will always have to think about how to aggregate and to simplify, as you also mentioned, right? And I think this is where these really simple and by now popular and well understood systems like grading scores come quite handy, because everyone simply knows how these work by now and can get a feeling of how of what a 4.8 or 4.9 star rating means in terms of quality or what to expect. Still, there is this little complication with this. And another point, you mentioned that multi-homing could be like something like a prerequisite in order to make this reasonable or work in the first place. And I don't really agree with this, since it's, imagine you're active only on one platform and still being able to get the reputation data you have there out there would allow you to start on a new platform. And the option alone may be a really powerful thing to have this backup option, right? I mean, there's a reason for the fact that you're by law in most countries allowed to port your phone number, your mobile phone number, even though you're typically not multi-homing in this market too. Right? You only have one phone number, but if you were not allowed, at least earlier, where people had to memorize phone numbers, if you were not allowed to port it, you were stuck with your current provider. So I think multi-homing is not a necessary criterion for that.
Yeah, interesting one. Yeah, thanks for that. I think it's really fair. And also, maybe only the option of multi-homing also gives the worker more autonomy and the platform less power. Glenn, you had a question I see in the chats.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks very much indeed for the great presentation and the facts and figures that have been presented here, Martin. And I've just got a quick question about the whole idea of openness and access to data. We've seen sort of precedents in the sort of the banking and financial sector whereby four different services to be able to integrate certain amounts of information need to be open source so that services and operators can share the data but also be active. Have you got any words to say about this, how these parallels could be brought into the platform and the gig economy too, so that we could have sensitive data could be kept safe and secure, but for operational perspectives, different services and new initiatives would still be able to work via the sharing of the most essential data that we've got as examples from other sectors too?
Yeah, interesting question. Also, I think a really big question. I think it's really good to look at different other industries that also had these questions about portability and also the effect on competition, but also on the entry level of new players in the markets, because sometimes sharing data can also make the gap or the threshold to start new initiatives even bigger. So then the incumbents, they're really happy by sharing, because then it's harder to start a new initiative. So I think it's really important to also look and learn from these other initiatives. I think what it makes hard with these reputation data is that there are no standards, like also with the financial industry, also like the PSD2, there are really clear standards. There's also really professional institutions and control around this. Well, this is of course a nearly non-regulated or institutionalized parts of the economy. I think it's also what you're also doing from your perspective, by also bringing the platforms together. I think it's also really important first step. But yeah, I think it's really important also to look at what other different data sharing and open standards had effects, and which also unintended consequences were there. Because I think that's also really important to look at it.
Yeah. Excellent, Martin. Thank you for that. And I think PSD2 is a great example of how to come together and create a bit of order and the starting point for taking the sector even further. So that's really good points there. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for your question. Albert also posted two interesting links in the chat, so you can also check them. And I think for now, also for sake of time, we're going to the discussion. there are three questions. Let's see, can I pin my again? Yes. We're going to be divided by Frederick in different groups. And the question is, okay, what would be the main driver to do this? And also, how does this contribute to the objectives of a platform and organizations? What are the main drawbacks? So in the end, to put it really simple, so what are the pros? And also for which kind of stakeholders? What are the cons? So what are the main drawbacks, which maybe would stop to do this right now? And also, what are then the solutions, how to fix it? And other questions. So it's quite an open discussion. To see the time, it's now 11:30. So let's say we pick 15 minutes for each to have the discussion in the groups. Also ask, and then we're going to ask one person of every group to just summarize the main thoughts and findings. so Frederick, if you could divide us into the groups, and then we'll be back in 15 minutes. You can see it on your screen. Join the breakout room. Thanks, Frederick.
Sverige. It's also possible there to get updates as soon as we update that website. I think it's really interesting the questions you are also asking the platforms and gig workers regarding this subject. I don't know if it would be possible to do a comparison with Sweden. I would also like to welcome you before we end to the workshop on the 1st of December. It will be mainly focused on the Swedish, the development of the gig economy in Sweden. But we will at that workshop bring all perspectives together. So I think that's really my last words. And thank you very much for today.
Yeah, thank you very much all. And so you received the email of Lisa. And if you have any thoughts, feel free to share. And let's hope to explore this interesting topic together on a other date. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.